Welcome everybody to our Psych Talks for fall 2020. This Psych Talk, we have Dr. Kate Speirs joining us today. A little bit about Dr. Speirs. Dr. Speirs got her bachelor's degree from Hamilton College in sociology. She got her master's degree from the University of Connecticut in human development and family studies. And she got her PhD from the University of Maryland in Family Science School of Public Health. After her postdoc, Dr. Speirs was hired as an extension specialist and assistant professor at the University of Arizona in the Norton School of Family and Consumer Services. Dr. Speirs is also an adjunct faculty at the University of Maryland. She is well published and has earned several research grants for her work, as well as awards. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce and turn the mic over to our speaker, Dr. Kate Speirs.
And thank you everyone for inviting me to be here today. I'm really excited to be here and to tell you a little bit about the research that I do and my work as an extension specialist. So I'm gonna go ahead and start this. And my computer has a little bit of a delay, hopefully. Okay, there we go. All right, so I am going to give you kind of a quick overview of a lot of different topics. So I'm gonna talk generally about cooperative extension and kind of give you a sense of what the cooperative extension system is, a little bit about what it looks like in California. And then I'm going to talk about some research that I worked on, the Feeding Young Children study, and how we took that research and used it to develop an online training for childcare providers. And I should also say, feel free to interrupt me if you have a question. You can also put your questions in the chat. I'm not sure that I'm able to see the chat while I'm presenting this PowerPoint slide or these PowerPoint slides. So if I ignore your question in the chat, I will get to it at the end. It's just that I can't see it right now. All right, so I'm gonna start by talking a little bit about what cooperative extension is. No worries if you have never heard those two words put together in this way before. A lot of people, even at my own university where we have cooperative extension, have not heard of it. But you might be aware of some of the programs that are run through cooperative extension. So I have three of what I think are probably the most popular or most well-known on the screen right now. So the 4-H program, which is a youth development program for middle and high school age students, is very popular. It's often thought of as like raising livestock for the county fair, but trust me, it's a lot more than just that at this point. So it really is a youth development program, and it touches on all topics. So extension, as you will see, sort of has an agricultural history and traditions, but we also, with 4-H, get into SNAP education, really anything that young people are interested in. The Master Gardener program in the middle there, that's how I was first introduced to cooperative extension. So Master Gardener is a program where community members take training on non-commercial agriculture. So growing a garden in your backyard, doing landscaping in your backyard, and then they're available as a community resource to other people in the community to help them with any gardening questions. So as a young child, my mother did a lot of gardening, and she would often drag me down to the cooperative extension office to ask the master gardener some questions. And then the last one that I have there is SNAP Ed, which is the nutrition education component of SNAP, or the food stamp program. And so people may not know it as SNAP Ed, but we provide a lot of nutrition education in all different settings. So in childcare centers, in K-12 schools, in community settings for adults, all across the board. So maybe you've heard of one of these extension programs. If you haven't, no worries. I'll kind of give you a broad overview of what extension is. So to talk about extension, I really have to talk about land-grant colleges or universities. So every state has at least one land-grant school. In California, it's the UC, University of California system. And all land-grant schools have a three-part mission, so education, research, and extension. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of background about these three components and what land-grant schools and extension are. So just a little bit of history. Way back in 1862, as this country was developing, Congressman Justin Morrill from Vermont suggested that it would probably be a good idea to have a college or university in every state for the people living in that state. So this is the, you know, mid to late 1800s. People were not traveling across country to go to college as we do today. People were not taking online courses using Zoom as we do today. So really, if people were going to go to college or university, it needed to be close, relatively close to them. So they suggested setting up a university system where each state would have a university or college. And they did that by the federal government provided grants of land in each state to the states that they could either sell or in some other way use to generate income that they could then use to establish a college or university system. Back then, these colleges were meant to specialize in agriculture and the mechanical arts. This is purely because at that point, this country was an agrarian society. Most people were farming. This is where they needed help. So they needed information and education in how to grow crops, how to manage farmland, how to manage natural resources, things like that.
Dr. Speirs, sorry to interrupt you. On our end, are you still on the first slide or have you progressed?
No, I'm not. Am I still on the first slide on your end though?
Yeah, we just wanted to double check. We didn't want to.
Okay, let me see if I can make a change and fix that. Okay. Give me one sec. And I'm actually going to stop sharing my screen for one second and I'll start again. All right. Can you see that I'm advancing the slides?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. So just to catch you up, so this is the three-part mission of land-grant schools. We talked about the Morrill Act, which established land-grant schools. And then this is a map of all of the land-grant schools in the U.S. So you can see that every state has at least one land-grant school. Those are the red dots, the 1862, those were the first schools to be established. In 1890, the White Stars, these are schools primarily in the Southeast, and they were historically Black colleges that were then brought into the land-grant school system. And then in 1994, similarly, the blue squares are tribal colleges that were brought into the land-grant school system. So in California, even though this green map does have two listed, when I did a little research, it looks like DQ University, which was a tribal college, has since gone, lost their accreditation and is no longer a university. So you're left with the University of California system. So these are the land grant schools in California, and Cooperative Extension is run through University of California. Okay, so we've talked about, I said there was a three-part mission, so education, so that was establishing colleges and universities. Research, they built that in 1887 with the Hatch Act. This is where they decided, well, we're doing great education, we should probably also be doing our own research at these universities. So again, mostly research at that point on agriculture and farming and using natural resources. The Hatch Act established what are called research experiment stations, and I have a couple pictures from some of those here. And these are places, sometimes they're on campus, often though they're at other parts of the state where research, university research can take place. So I will say, given our sort of agrarian agricultural traditions and history, most of the research that goes on at these ag experiment stations is related to research or agriculture or natural resources, but that's not entirely true. All right, and so we've talked about education research, and then in 1914, we bring in extension with the Smith-Lever Act. So they decided, you know, we're doing great things on campus and at these research experiment stations, but if we really want a system that benefits everyone in the state, we know not everyone is going to come to the university for formal education. So we really need to take the education and the research that's going on campus and make sure that it gets back out into the community so that everyone benefits from it. And so they decided to do that through the extension system. So the Smith-Lever Act in 1914 set up an extension system, which is basically a set of extension offices across the state. In Arizona, for example, we only have 15 counties in Arizona, so we have one extension office in each county. But other states that have more counties sometimes have an office that covers multiple counties. So these are offices where university employees work, and they essentially develop programs and other non-formal education for the people in their community. So the idea is that they're really embedded in the community. In a lot of places, there's a rule that if you work in an extension office, you also have to live in that county. And so the idea is that you're a member of that community, you are connected to all of the stakeholders in your area, in your county, and that you really have a feel for what's going on. You do a lot of needs assessment work to figure out what needs the community has in your area and then provide programming to address them. All right, so this is our current definition from USDA of cooperative extension. So extension provides non-formal education. So again, this is that contrast between formal education that takes place on campus. All of the educational programming that extension provides is non-formal. No one's working towards a degree or receiving credits for it. So non-formal education and learning activities to people throughout the country. So again, extension is in every state and Washington, DC, and some of the territories. To farmers and other residents of rural communities. So here again, you can see that agricultural history, that is sort of our strength, is providing services and programming to rural communities. We have strong ties to rural communities, often in places where there really aren't a lot of other services. But then there's also an acknowledgement within extension that most people today in the U.S. live in an urban area. So we're also working to provide programming for people living in urban areas. Extension emphasizes taking knowledge gained through research and education and bringing it directly to the people to create positive changes. So that's really the whole idea behind extension, is we take that research and education that's going on campus and make sure it gets out to people. So it can benefit them. All right, so just to provide a little bit more background, so extension in the past was largely focused on direct education, so going out and providing a workshop or a training or a series of classes to a group of people, so providing education right to the end user. Certainly we have this agricultural history, and we're sort of have a history of working in rural communities. So we sort of started with agriculture, and then home economics was sort of a convenient partner. So, you know, if people are growing food, they also need to know how to safely can it, bake it, think about sowing and things like nutrition. You often find nutrition departments in colleges of agriculture and working with extension. So extension today has certainly evolved. We still do a lot of direct education, but we also do what we call policy systems and environment work. So here the idea is that we develop programs and intervention and change strategies that really work on those higher level policy systems and environments that impact people's lives. In the area of extension that I work in, a lot of this work is done through that SNAP Ed or Nutrition Education Program. And so thinking about how can we change the environment? If we put up lights on a playground, will people be able to use that playground longer into the night? And will it be a safer place for people to gather in the evenings and afternoon? And will that increase physical activity? So that's kind of a contrast to a direct education program where maybe you go and you teach people a sport or teach them about the importance of physical activity. There's also a focus on, there's still certainly a focus on agriculture, but in some parts of extension, there's also a focus on health. So we have a national framework for health and wellness. And the idea really is to utilize that network of people and resources across each state and across the country to help improve the nation's health and well-being. And then also, as I mentioned, there's an acknowledgement that most people do live in urban areas and that we should be providing programming that's specific to those communities. All right, so I did a little bit of research on what extension in California and in your local area. So I hope I got this right. I think this Humboldt County office is probably the local extension office for you guys when you're on campus. And so this is in Eureka, and the website is down here on the bottom right. And these tiles across the screen are the different program areas that they listed on their website. So this kind of gives you an idea of all the different areas that Extension works in. So 4-H is that youth development program that I mentioned. They do work with agriculture. They have fire prevention programs, it looks like. Forestry and fire health, livestock, a master food preserver program, which is to help people safely do things like canning at home. The master gardener program that I talked about before, and then it looks like a nutrition or probably nutrition education program. So lots of good things going on. And this is just one extension office, and what they're offering is going to be different than what's offered in other extension offices in California or in other states, because did you intend to mute me? Oh, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yes. It looks like I was muted for a second.
I think there was competition for the waiting room at that point. I think somebody misclicked. Sorry about that, Dr. Speirs.
No, no problem. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't talking away and no one could hear me. All right, so I was saying these are all the programs that are offered in this one extension office. The programming that's offered in extension offices will look different in different communities because different communities have different needs. So there might not be a fire prevention program, for instance, in every area, because that's not an issue for every community. All right, let's see, okay, there we go. So now I'm gonna switch gears a little bit and tell you about some research that I worked on, and then how we use this research study to develop an online training for childcare providers. So the Feeding Young Children study is focused on childcare providers and how they feed young children. So the focus is on caregiver feeding practices. And this is really looking at how caregivers feed young children. Sometimes they're referred to as food parenting practices, because most of this literature looks at parents rather than childcare providers. But the idea here is really looking at how providers and parents and other caregivers feed young children. So not so much what they're feeding them, but what meal times look like, what rules they set up around food, how they encourage kids to eat or to try new foods. Things like that. Caregiver feeding practices are important because they may reinforce or undermine a child's ability to self-regulate energy intake. So we know that when babies are born, they have an innate ability to regulate how many calories they take in or how much energy they take in. They don't really need anyone to tell them how much to eat. Around age 2 or 3, we start to see that some kids lose that ability. And it's likely because of cues that they're getting from the environment that kind of override those internal cues. So when very well-meaning parents encourage a child to finish everything that's on their plate, which parents are always doing that with the best of intentions, but what it can sometimes do is encourage maybe a child who feels hungry to continue eating. So sort of overriding those internal feelings of hunger or fullness with these external cues. Caregiver feeding practices are also an important area for intervention because they've been shown to be associated with what foods kids consume and how much they consume, their weight status, as well as food preferences, mostly around fruit and vegetable preferences. All right, and as I said, most of the research in this area focuses on parents, so I wanted to focus on childcare providers because they're also an important source of care for young children. My focus here was 3 to 5 year old or preschool age children, and as we well know, most preschool age children spend a fair amount of time in non-parental care. So they're eating a fair number of meals with a non-parental caregiver. So the study aims here, this was a mixed method study. We did some survey data collection with an online survey as well as in-depth interviews that we did over the phone. So all of the data was collected from childcare providers and we used the survey data to describe providers' use of best practices around feeding young children. And then we also collected survey responses from providers working in childcare centers, Head Start centers, and family daycare centers. And so then we were able to examine if there were differences between those three settings. We also used in-depth phone interviews to explore the provider's understanding and use of feeding practices in detail. So really getting at their perspectives, what do they do? Why do they do it? How do they do it? Those kinds of things. All right, so in terms of data collection, we ended up with a survey sample of 343. About 70% completed the survey online, 30% completed a paper version. We included the knapsack items as our measures of feeding practices. We also looked at, because we were doing this research with the goal of developing a program in mind, we wanted to know about providers' use and ability to access technology. We sort of had the idea going in that we wanted to develop an online program or online training, but we wanted to make sure that that would work for childcare providers. And then we also, in the interviews, and on the survey, we talked about their training preferences or their preferences for training. In the phone interviews, we had a purposely selected sample of 50, and I'll show you how that broke down, I think on the next slide. The phone interviews lasted between about 45 minutes and 2 hours, and we talked to providers about mealtimes, what do mealtimes in your home look like? Strategies for feeding children, and again, tried to get at their preferences around. All right, so in the top corner here, the top right corner, this is how our sample broke down. So we wanted to make sure that we had providers from home-based care settings, center-based care, as well as Head Start centers. There are differences in the regulations that govern these three kinds of care facilities. There's also differences in access to training and professional development, as well as just different guidelines that they have to follow. So we figured there probably would be differences in the feeding practices they were using. Similarly, we wanted to make sure we had providers who both participated in the CACFP program and those who didn't. CACFP is a federal nutrition subsidy. Providers are reimbursed for healthy meals that they provide to young children in their care. And we wanted to have providers who both did not participate in this program, because if you do participate in this program, it's likely that you have access to additional training and resources around many topics, but potentially around feeding practices. So there might be differences based on participation in this program. And all Head Start teachers and all Head Start centers are automatically eligible for CACFP. So that's why we didn't have any non-CACFP Head Start teachers. Our inclusion criteria was that they had to be currently employed as a child care provider or Head Start teacher, employed in a facility licensed in Illinois. So this data, I'm in Arizona now, but this data was collected in Illinois. They had to be responsible for feeding 3 to 5 year old children a main meal, so breakfast, lunch, or dinner, at least 3 times a week. So we really wanted to talk to the people who were feeding young kids. We didn't want to talk to center directors or assistant teachers who didn't have a role in meal times. All right, so our survey sample, we ended up with about half were home-based childcare providers, about a third were center-based, and the remainder were Head Start teachers. About 80% participated in CACFP. Most of our sample, about 3/4, was white, another 17% African American. 60% of our sample had a high school degree, GED, or associate's degree. The providers in our survey sample had been working as a child care provider for about 10 years, and they were on average 60 years old. The interview sample, really the places where this looked different than the survey sample is in the top two variables. So we purposely sampled 40 home-based providers, 40 center-based, and 20 Head Start, so that we would get, we would be able to compare between the settings. And then in doing that, as I mentioned, no Head Start teachers don't participate in CACFP. So then we ended up with 60% participating in CACFP. In terms of these other demographic variables, they looked very similar to the survey sample. All right, so we collected this data and then we started looking through it to see how providers were doing in terms of best practices around feeding. And what we found was that on a lot of the feeding practices that we asked about, providers were doing exactly what we would want them to be doing, or most of them were. So if you look here at the second one that I've listed, like 88% of providers said that they never had TV or videos on during meal or snack time. So this is important because there's some research suggesting that when you eat while watching TV or videos, you're more likely to eat in the absence of hunger, to overeat. And so, you know, but most of them were saying they weren't doing that. So for most of the feeding practices, it looked pretty good. They were, you know, sort of doing what we, or at least saying that they were doing what we would expect them to do. What really stood out for that reason was when we looked at a couple of our questions around role modeling, that's where we really saw that far fewer providers reported meeting best practices. So only 44% said that they were enthusiastically role modeling, eating the healthy foods that are served at every meal and snack time. And we defined enthusiastically role modeling as both eating foods in front of the children and showing them how much you enjoy the food. And only about 40% said that they always ate or drank the same foods and beverages as the children. So these were two areas of concern. We looked at this in a little bit more detail. So we broke it down by the kind of care facility that they were working in. So the gray bars is our full sample. The orange bars are the Head Start, the blue, the center-based, and the yellow home-based. So if you look at the second two, or the last two questions here around enthusiastically role modeling, healthy eating, and always eating and drinking the same beverages, or foods and beverages, there you can really see that when you break it down by the type of care facility, Head Start seems to be doing a little bit better, or in some cases a lot better than the other two settings. And then centers seem to be kind of in the middle, and home base seems to be really where there might be reason for concern. So only about 32% of home-based providers said they were enthusiastically role modeling, and only about 27% said they were always eating or drinking the same foods and beverages as children. The first two that I have here are never eating snack foods in front of the kids and never eating sweets, and pretty much across the board, all providers said that they were doing what we would want them to do, so they were never doing that. So we then turned to our interview data to probe this a little bit more to figure out, you know, what was going on here. And we found when we looked at the interview responses that providers, for the most part, reported that it was important to eat healthy foods in front of the children. So this was pretty widely reported, pretty widely accepted. Where we saw fewer people talking about a best practice was in reporting the use of enthusiastically eating the food. So talking about how much you enjoy eating healthy foods, having a smile on your face while you eat them, rather than just sort of passively eating them in front of the kids. The providers in our sample also were aware of and talked about how peer modeling was successful. So they understood that, you know, if there was a child who struggled to eat healthy foods, they could maybe, if they could show him that another child was eating the healthy foods, that that might help encourage the first child. So they understood, you know, the importance of kids watch each other and will copy each other. They did talk about role modeling mostly being done during mealtime. So they weren't really looking for opportunities during the rest of the day to talk about healthy eating or talk about how they made decisions around, you know, which healthy foods to eat, things like that. And then we found that providers also talked about wanting to do more role modeling, but not being able to because of a lack of resources or limited opportunities for role modeling. So especially in the home-based settings, they talked about either not having enough food for themselves to eat the healthy foods that they were serving to the kids. We should note that the CACFP program that I told you about doesn't reimburse for providers' meals, it just reimburses for kids' meals. So sometimes if there wasn't extra resources to provide a serving or a helping for providers, they just didn't have those healthy foods to eat. This also became more complicated in centers serving low-income children, where providers were really hesitant to take any food away from the kids, knowing that maybe the meals that they had at the child care center were the only meals they were going to get that day. And then also some of the home-based providers talked about just not having like a physical setup for their center that would help them sit and eat with young kids. So they sometimes talked about having to serve meals to some kids in the kitchen and other kids in another room, and then kind of going back and forth between those two. Or also just because they're more likely to care for kids of different ages, they might not be able to sit down with preschool age kids while they're eating because they have other responsibilities to older, younger kids. All right, so then, as I said, we also were interested in looking at technology use and access to think about, is an online training, is that appropriate for childcare providers? Would that work well? So overwhelmingly, the answer to that was yes. We found that providers said they would be interested in online training, that they and we think the little dip here for Head Start, only 76% of them said they're interested in online, might be because they get or they have access to a lot of in-person training through their Head Start center. So if they're going to do that anyway, they might not be interested in additional online programming. They also, when asked about their preferred method or least preferred, most of them identified online classes or workshops as a preferred method and didn't identify those as a least preferred method. Also, overwhelmingly, these providers reported that they had access to technology, so they were using the internet. When they did do online trainings, though, they reported for the most part that they were using desktop or laptop computers, which is important because you often want to develop the training for the kind of device that people are going to use. So if it's going to be viewed on a cell phone, it might be designed a little bit differently than if it's going to be viewed on a desktop or laptop computer. All right, so then some conclusions that we drew from this research. Certainly it looks like there's a need for training on role modeling, and we should focus on how to role model. So how to show enthusiasm for eating healthy foods, how to make sure you're able to eat and drink the same foods as the children. Looked like it wouldn't be a problem to deliver training online, and that we really should be developing something that's accessible on desktops or laptops, computers, as well as cell phones and tablets. So in some areas, there's a push towards all mobile friendly and really designing for tablets and cell phones, but that's probably not the best approach for this group of people. All right, so we took that research and those conclusions, and then we were interested in putting together a training for childcare providers. So I'm going to take you through how we developed that and pilot tested it. So in terms of program development, once we had identified role modeling as the target, we then went back and did an exhaustive literature search to really look at what do we know about role modeling, what components of role modeling are effective, and specifically around role modeling healthy eating. The interesting thing about the role modeling literature is there are a lot of experimental studies, and they really get down into kind of the nitty gritty of how do you encourage young children to eat healthy food. So, you know, everything from, you know, does it matter who the model is? Do peers work as well as adults? Should the model be the same gender as the child? Should they be a different gender? Should the model be smiling while eating the foods? Do they have to eat the same foods as the kids? Do they just have to sit with the kids? So there's a lot of detail. I will note that this literature is limited in that some of the samples are relatively small, which is just kind of a function of the kinds of studies that they're designing. They're not really, it's not possible to do these with huge samples. And it, like a lot of the research, unfortunately, focuses probably too much on white middle class children. So it's a little unclear if it generalizes beyond that. But there was a lot of good research here that we could use to, along with our research, to start to develop the training. So the main takeaways that we took from this were adults should certainly be eating with the children and eating the same foods as children. Adults should enthusiastically talk about enjoying the foods they're eating and have positive facial expressions while eating, that stuff does matter. And then that adult and peer models are both important for encouraging healthy eating. All right, so in putting together this training, we took a dialogue learning approach. So this is an approach to adult education that really kind of tries to move away from the idea of like an expert teacher at the front of the classroom and then people who are there to learn or who don't have knowledge in that subject. So it makes it more learner-centered, more about the learner and their experiences and hearing about their experiences and really giving them this information that they can start to use during the class. There's also a big focus on learning through talking or writing and actively using the information. So not just providing information or helping people sort of understand or memorize it, but getting them to the point where they're actually actively using it. And then this approach also values participants' experiences. So again, getting away from this idea that there's like one expert in the room and that's the person leading the training. All right, so a dialogue learning approach usually has four components, anchor, add, apply, and away. So these are like the pieces that make up each session of the training. So we renamed some of those for our training, but the anchor, what we call the warm-up activities, are things that really introduce the topic to the learners and connect it to their lives. So really make the case for why does this matter? Why should you care about this training? Why should you care about the information you're going to receive? In the learn piece, this is where you provide new information. And there's really a focus that this is just one component of what you do during a training. It's not, and it shouldn't be what you spend most of your time on, that you give people sort of an easy to digest piece of information, not too much information at once. And then during the apply section, this is where you allow people to use the new information so they can really think through it, make sure that they understand it by actually using it. And then during the away or plan piece, this is where you give people a chance to set goals and really think about how am I going to use this new information in a concrete way, like next week after I leave this training. All right, so we put together a 4-unit online training. In the first unit, we introduce role modeling and the importance of role modeling. In the second unit, we talk about role modeling healthy eating during meal times. In the third unit, we talk about peer role modeling. And in the fourth unit, role modeling healthy eating outside of meal times. So I'm just going to give you a couple examples of what some of those sections of our training looked like. So in the warm-up, this is where we, this was kind of the introduction where we asked people to think about how does this information apply to their lives. So here in one of the first two units, I think maybe in the first one, we have a prompt for providers to think about the last time they noticed that the preschool age children they care for were imitating or copying what they saw them. So really getting them in the mindset to think about this. We also, in this warm-up, we used quotes from the interviews so that providers could hear other providers talk about role modeling and how they were successfully using it, how they found it useful, what it looked like when they did it in their center. In the learn section, again, this is where we provided some new information. We had references. We tried to use mostly open access articles when we were using journal articles so that if people were interested, they could go and learn more about the topic, and again, kind of providing pretty easily digestible pieces of information. We also made a point of, you know, providing something that they could do. So talk about the rewards of eating healthy foods, and then also provide them with some sample dialogue or sentences that they might say. So not just do this, but here's how to do this. Here's what it might look like. During the apply section, this is where we often gave them scenarios and asked them to think through what would you do in this situation. Because we can kind of tell you what you should be doing, but then it never quite works that way in practice. So we took examples from the interviews to think about what might be some scenarios that people might run into where this isn't going to work perfectly and how should they do those. So we give people a scenario, give them some time to reflect on it, and then give them some suggestions of what they might do. And then in the plan section, this is where we asked people to write down, you know, what are two things that you're gonna do in the next 2 months add a fruit or vegetable component to activities that you do in your center or your classroom. So really asking people to make a concrete plan, and then they would be able to print these out so that they could use them after the training. Okay, so once we had a draft version of the training completed, we asked some cooperative extension educators and public health professionals to review the training. They went through the training online. They took a 20-question survey also online to kind of guide them in providing feedback. So we asked them about everything from the content. Did they feel like it was appropriate, complete, clear? The layout was the way it was laid out in the online program. Was it easy to navigate, easy to understand? You know, did they understand how to advance to the next lesson? Things like that. And then we wanted to know about any technical issues. So if there were any glitches that people ran into, you know, we wanted to know about that. So once we received this feedback, we made revisions to the training, and then we pilot tested the revised version. So we had 57 childcare providers complete the online training. They also completed a 31-question evaluation survey that asked them about their satisfaction with the training, the knowledge that they felt like they gained, and then their intent to change behavior following the course. And so overall, we found that participants were pretty satisfied with the course. They felt it was helpful. They rated it as excellent or good. They also reported an increase in knowledge. So about 3/4 reported that they increased their knowledge about how to role model healthy eating, how to use peer modeling, and how to incorporate healthy foods and into activities that take place outside of mealtime. So those were the topics of the three of our units. They reported intending to change their behavior. So there was a 71% increase in participants who said that they would enthusiastically role model healthy eating at every meal. We asked them that question before they took the training and then after. And also a 30% increase in participants who said they would always or often eat the same foods as the children. Okay, so sort of future plans for this, certainly wider dissemination, making sure that it gets to home-based providers who seem to be at, have the most need for training in this area, a larger and more in-depth evaluation study, and certainly with a 6-month or so follow-up evaluation to see if they, you know, not just intent to change, but if they actually have any changes. And then we're also working to apply to make sure that the training counts towards the training hours that childcare providers have to have for their licensure. All right, so I did want to wrap this up by acknowledging all of the people who helped me with this. Just like anything, we don't do any of this work alone. I was lucky to work with a great team of mentors, some great graphic designers, as well as all of the participants who participated in each of the stages of this, and some research assistants both at University of Illinois and University of Arizona. So that is all I have for you today. We do still have some time, and I'm happy to stick around for a while to answer any questions. And then also my email address is here. Feel free to email me, reach out if you have any questions about extension or my research or program.
Thank you, Dr. Speirs. As mentioned, does anybody have any questions, comments about what was spoken about? Please feel free to throw them in the chat. Wait, what? Apparently people can't unmute themselves. I do apologize about that.
Hi, Kate.
Hi. How are you?
I'm good. Sorry, Erin, I had to say hello. I haven't seen Kate in a while.
I know. I wish I was there with you guys in person.
Oh, you'd love it. Can I start the questions as people put the questions in the chat?
Yeah, and but before you go, just to throw that out there, if you don't want to unmute your microphone, please feel free to throw your questions in the chat, and we will be happy to facilitate them to Kate as well. Go ahead, Maria.
Oh, cool. So I know your focus is with childcare providers, but you know, I see kids go to childcare, and then I come and I see them at home, and I often wonder, like, are parents sort of derailing what you're doing, or are they reinforcing what you're doing? Like, you know, you go to a restaurant and you see a parent eat all your food and you're like, oh. So have there been any thought about maybe trying to see what's happening at home?
Yeah, yes, absolutely. And most of this research actually does focus on what goes on at home. So there are fewer people, it's increasing, but there are fewer people who look at this in childcare setting. So most of the research on home. But yeah, there often are different things going on in those two settings. And that was that those connections between home and childcare are really interesting to me. And how do you bridge gaps and get everybody on the same page? So I did ask about that in interviews. And it's interesting because especially, I don't know, feeding is so personal, and providers often would talk about, you know, maybe not being super happy with how the parents were feeding kids, or, you know, their rules about food, or, you know, that they'd see them walk in with a soda in their hand when they came into the center in the morning, but also really reluctant to talk to parents about that. So it can be a hard topic to raise. And certainly in settings like Head Start, where they know parents have limited resources, they may be doing the best that they can. So, so yeah, I'm really interested in thinking about how do we kind of help providers think about themselves as advocates? How do we help them teach parents about healthy eating, but also in a realistic way? Because it is kind of a difficult subject to talk about. And they would also talk about how they sometimes felt like that, the like anything about eating or health really was not have the knowledge. They'd rather leave that to pediatricians and health professionals, and they didn't feel like they could start those conversations with parents. But it can be really close. I think it's an opportunity to provide some education. But yeah, it's difficult.
Thank you.
Sure.
Other questions, or I can keep going?
You keep going, Maria.
Yeah, please.
It'll spark
keep going,
some
Maria.
Questions.
You know me. I know Kate, so that's part of it. Like, I know what she's been doing. So so the other thing is you know me and you know the research I do.
Yes.
And so I understand that it's typically white middle class. What are the efforts of trying to expand that? Because I've seen the demographics of childcare providers change in regards to this, but you're right in that I don't see a lot of research on those practices. And, you know, anecdotally, I have a friend who's her whole, you know, center for care for her daughters, it's all run by non-white people, and the food they eat, I'm like, dang, that's that. And it's all freshly prepared. Like, they make these huge efforts. And so it's really amazing, but I'm like, hey, but there's no research on you. So is it simply that they're just not enough, or that they're just less willing to participate in the research?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think there is an acknowledgement that we need to be doing this research, certainly with diverse groups in terms of economic status, so looking at low-income families because they have different constraints around food, and providers working in centers where it's interesting because there are so many dynamics going on here. So the provider status, as well as the kids. So It was only one provider, but I had one provider talk to me, you know, and often low income or childcare providers are low income workers, low wage workers, don't make as much as they should. And so they may be struggling with issues around food insecurity as well as the kids in some settings. And so I think those dynamics are really interesting. And then in terms of racial ethnic diversity, I think there is some effort to look at Latinx families or care providers, African American as well. So I think it's moving in that direction. I think, you know, just like everything else, maybe white researchers at universities had access to primarily middle class samples, especially if you're going to recruit people in a center, if you want to go into a center to do research, not like rather than bringing people to the lab. It might, you know, if you have kids in a center that serves primarily middle-class families, that's the least where you're going to start. But there's also a lot of research that's been done in Head Start. So we're getting some diversity there as well. Yeah.
Thank you. There's a question in the chat.
Yeah, it asks if this training could be provided to parents simultaneously.
That's a good question. I don't think this exact training would make much, it might not make sense for parents just because those are two different care settings. So child care providers, you know, it is their profession, often have more kids to care for than parents. And for home-based providers, at least might have kids of more diverse ages. But certainly something similar could absolutely be developed for parents and has been. Other people have developed similar things for parents. And there's a lot of overlap. It's just more sort of in the details. And I think you would want to tailor something like this as much as you could to your audience, which is why I might be a little reluctant. And then certainly a lot of childcare providers are themselves parents. So there's overlap there too.
Maria may have touched on this already because culture, I apologize if I'm repeating the question, but with that in mind, obviously different cultures react to different emotions or different features differently. Do you think that's something that could be tailored to, like when you do expand this out to other than middle white class people? I apologize, my question's not very clear, but perhaps tailor like one of the things you brought up was like smiling to the kids when you were mimicking the food that they're eating. Perhaps changing that up a little bit to maybe match the kids that are being trained or the parents that are being trained, perhaps.
Yeah, I think that would be a really interesting piece to look at, because if that's not like culturally appropriate, it could seem out of place, and then it could have a totally different message than if it is sort of part of your culture or expected or and I think that's why we really need more research with diverse groups, so because we can't just assume that it's going to work the same in all of these in different communities. So absolutely, yeah, and I think that probably is a really good place to think about. Another thing that came out in a lot of the interviews, and this is kind of a common dilemma, and I don't think we really know the answer to this, but when you as the provider don't like the food that you're serving, what do you do? Because you're supposed to role model, right? And you're supposed to show the children that you enjoy eating it. And providers had a whole range of, you know, how they handled that. So some of them went way over the top and were like earning, you know, Academy Awards and pretending like they liked this food. And then some of them said, you know, I just tell kids, like, I don't like broccoli. It's not my favorite. I'll eat the peas when we have those or the carrots, but this isn't my favorite. And I think we, you know, we probably just need more research. And maybe that varies based on culture as well, to think about, yeah, how might those messages be understood differently. I'm suspicious. I mean, kids know more than we think they do. So I'm suspicious that I think they know when providers are faking. When they're pretending like they like something. So I'm not sure if that's effective or not. But then there's also some you know, experimental research showing that if you're sitting at a table eating and the adult, the model, makes a negative comment about a food, then even kids who'd eaten that food previously or expressed a preference for it won't eat it during that mealtime. Now, maybe at the next, you know, in the next mealtime, they'll come back eating it. But I think, yeah, we need more research to better understand these things.
Because there's total food practices where, like, if you don't clean your plate, that's like extremely offensive in a culture. Like, exactly. You know, if you don't, you know, or you know, there's just so many different things, like with the, like, you should, in other cultures, it's like you should leave a little bit behind to show that the person actually provided enough food, that you're so full that you couldn't clean at your plate because they just did such a great job. So, I mean, there are some cultural practices that are around food that, you know, send very different messages and very different expectations.
Yeah, absolutely.
Another question in the chat.
That would be
I can kind of clarify that too, Aaron. Just give me a minute so I'm not talking over the top of my wife.
I'll say it. Clarification is needed. We'll have you jump in. So it seems like establishing these practices early, almost at the onset, is important. Is there an optimal period to work on changing children's eating habits by implementing these changes, even if some of these problematic behaviors have been introduced/modeled?
And then was there clarification? Or I mean, I think I understand that, but okay. It's around age 2 or 3 that we see kids start to be more responsive to environmental external cues about eating. But I don't want to give the impression that you can't relearn this at any point in your life. So I'm not exactly sure if there is critical period research or, you know, it has to be done at this time. I don't think so. I think this could be a lifelong pursuit. You hear about sort of more mindful eating for adults. And I think that comes from the same ideas that you want to be more responsive to what's going on inside and how full you are, rather than external cues or things like that. So I think I don't think there's a critical period where you must learn this. And I do, you know, all babies are born with this. So it's sort of unlearning it and then relearning it.
Okay, I have another one. Yeah. It's because I'm currently living with my sister and her kids and there's a 4-year-old in the house.
Oh no, don't tell her at dinner tonight, but Kate said you have to do this.
But there are certain foods you want your kids to eat. And it's interesting because what we've noticed is, and this happens with children, right, is that their taste buds, as they start adjusting, like something they love, they start to hate. And then it's like, you used to eat it before. Like, and so then it becomes this sort of struggle and you're trying to role model, you know, good eating habits. But all of a sudden, all I want is mac and cheese and nothing else.
Yeah.
And you're like, but you used to eat the green beans.
Yeah.
So is there any way to account to, like, you know, because the taste buds are changing and all that kind of stuff, is there any way to account for that kind of stuff in trying to role model? Because, I mean, it's happening.
Yeah, so. And I think just not making that into a battle and just continuing to role model, so continuing yourself to eat the healthy foods, even if the child is not interested in it, you know, at that point, and just, you know, continuing to eat them, continuing to talk about how you enjoy them. When you're in the grocery store talking about, you know, we're going to get broccoli and blueberries and these are healthy and all of that, you know, if you're reading books, there are a lot of books about healthy eating and fruits and vegetables. So maybe bringing it into other parts of the day. So it's not, if it becomes meal times, you know, kind of reading about it, talking about it at other points during the day and just and continuing to offer. So there's also, some literature that shows you might have to offer usually a new food about 15 times before a child is willing to eat it and accept it and express a preference for it. So, and that's also hard when you're talking about low-income families because they don't always have extra money to be offering food to people who they know are probably not going to eat it. So you need to think of like creative solutions for that as well. But if, you know, if possible, just continuing to make it available. There's a lot you can do in the home environment. I mean, it's hard. I been in trainings where parents are like, okay, I'll feed my kids the healthy foods, but I'm still going to have my junk food, you know, in the cabinet above the refrigerator that they can't get to. So, you know, what does that food environment look like? Is it, you know, do you leave a bowl of fruit out on the counter for kids to just kind of older kids, but, you know, kids to come by and eat when they get hungry? Or is there a bowl of candy bars or something like that? So you can make a lot of changes to the food environment as well. But yes, definitely picky eating is a thing and it's a challenge and yeah.
Any additional or last minute questions, anybody? Okay, well, at this point, I'm gonna stop the recording. To those of you who are watching the recording after the event, thank you so much for watching. We appreciate it. We have one more talk coming up from the semester, so please look forward to that. But if you're watching this later on, thank you very much for watching and have a great rest of your day.
All right, thank you, everyone.